2BK4165. Thank you. Yes, getting back to the lover of my life. And he looks so handsome today, as always. I love this gentleman for many reasons. When he said to me so many years ago that God said to him, that you would be my wife, I said, me. Because I started to look at assets, says the man who grows assets, nice things, you know, because I had my plans, I had a checklist, and he wasn't in that checklist. So I said, God, how are you going to do with this? I ain't want no poor church rat. I want a rich man. But he must fear God, he must love God. But he must be rich, because when you come from poverty, you don't want to get back into poverty. But the essence of the story is, God said to me, he said, this man loves me, he fears me, and he's going to be. So I said, God, okay, I'm going to take your word for it. That's what he said to me. He literally said that in my ears. This man loves me and he fears me. Don't worry about anything else. Watch the future. So I decided to put him on my checklist. And so today he has been a very good husband, excellent husband. Can I say this to you? Excellent husband. I've seen him where you can't see him. I've seen when he's hurting, because my pillow is the closest to his. So as I watch him hurt over things that never should have happened, but happens because that's life, I said to myself, I'm gonna stand with him regardless. He has never given me one reason not to stand with him.
Amen.
And to stand by his side. So today he's the father of four children. He's the father of four children. We have four children together. Juanita, who's chairing the program. Adele, who's standing there. Phoebe, the tallest Cameron. The shortest Cameron, and Brian on the drums. I remember when I said to him, he had all these girls and I lost one girl, she went back to glory to be with Jesus. I said to him, I can try one more time. He said he was finished. As a matter of fact, he was finished at Juanita. And I said, no way, Jose, no. This Caribbean girl ain't stopping at no one child. So I decided, you know we do our thing and children come, right? Good. He said to me, Roxanne, no more children because another girl would come. So I said, so what? So every time I said, God, we need a son. And when the son came, I didn't even know. So it so happened that Brian came 5 years after Phoebe. And he said to me, what we're up in age, I was about 35, they're about 36. And he's saying, girl, you know, you're getting up there. I said, that's what man say. That's what man say. And so we have four children. He's been in the ministry, this is 40 years as a licensed and ordained minister in October. He started in 1975, and that's when he gained his first. And today,
40 years after.
But he was with the mics. 40 years after, he's still standing, and he has an excellent family backing him. The children said to us, all of you here would know, adversity hit at some point in time in 2007, 2008. And when adversity hit home, we stood with him. We said, we're going to be with you regardless what the world does. Church does. And today, it's history. We're 7 years strong as Lighthouse. He has given us good leadership.
Amen, amen.
I know I'm not an easy wife. And I'm a tough wife, a tough mom. I said to my children, you will not lost away. Mr. Lockett, I said to my children, you won't lost away United States. You're not going to be negative stats in this country. You're going to be positive statistics. And today I'm proud to tell you that they are. Juanita, Adele, Phoebe, Brian. And so I want to introduce him. And just before he comes to take this microphone, we will have our dancers. And you need to know, I love this man with a passion. Look at his face. Handsome today. I told him we were dressing to come in the bathroom. I said, I'm going to big you up today, boy. He was like, no, I'm going to do it. Tell him every day, I love you, Jack. I love you. And so he doesn't have to worry about my love for him. So I want to introduce this gentleman to you, who is a man of God. He fears the Lord. He loves the Lord with a passion. He has taken many things for Jesus. And so it's my pleasure to say, Cammy, I love you, boy.
Of everything, I will exalt him, his name adore.
Good afternoon, Lighthouse. It is customary in our church to stand for the reading of the word. I'm reading from the Authorized King James Version, Daniel 1, verse 9 and 10. From verse 8, 9, and 10. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with a portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Now God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. And the prince of the eunuchs said unto Daniel, I fear my lord the king, who had appointed your meat and your drink. For why should he see your face worse liking than the children which are of your serf? Then shall he make me endanger my head to the king. Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
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 Today I'm going to be short, sleep deprived. I've been going many days from this place, 2 o'clock in the morning, coming back at 7 in the morning. There were times we would switch positions and my wife would come early and she would be here while the men are working, because the people who installed the sprinklers in this building would come to work for 6:30 in the morning and leave at 2 o'clock. And while we're doing that, I also have to be preparing for Bible study and preparing for Sunday. It was a tough call. But God gave the strength and the grace to get it done. And I just give God praise and give God thanks for what he has done. Today, every year, God gives me a particular theme for the church. And for this year, it was walking in God's divine purpose, God's divine favor and purpose. And they fed off of that and gave us something that we've come this far by faith. And we want to thank God. I also want to acknowledge the folks in the other three overflow rooms, so that you don't feel you're out there and nobody thinking about you. Those of you in the three overflow rooms, we just want to acknowledge you and let you know you're part of what is happening here today. Please acknowledge them on my right, acknowledge them on my left. Amen. I thought about what Daniel said in verse 8. Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not be defiled by the meat which came from the king's table. Daniel made a conscious decision not to be defiled. We live in a time when it is not easy to find people who are going to commit themselves to the principles of the Word of God. There's always a little cut here and a little cut around the corner. Just the other day we decided as a church, because I found some mistakes in the new translation of the NIV, that we would go back to the old King James Version and stay with when thou comest, when thou risest in the morning, when thou sittest, when thou eatest thy food, because we believe that we need to stay with the authentic word of God.
Amen.
And hold on to it.
Amen.
When I think of the theme of walking in God's divine favor and purpose, or God's divine favor and purpose, I think of how God favored us here at this church. You don't know our story, except I tell you our story. 10 years ago, when I came to this country, did have a need to come. I was one of those few Guyanese who never had a need to come. I was pastoring a very large church, on television, on radio. Things were working well for me. I was living in a gated community, and God was blessing. Children were in private school. And God came and upset all of that and brought me to this place among the people that I had not known, and to share his word with them. And God said, I'm sending you to help a people. But suddenly, the people that God sent me to help didn't want to help. Did not want to help. And God decided to turn things around. Like I said yesterday in the prayer breakfast, as a result of their refusing to help, Lighthouse is what? Let me say it again. As a result of their refusing what God was offering, Lighthouse emerged. Let me say to you that whenever I go to our board meetings, my blood pressure at Lighthouse is normal. When I went to board meetings in the other place that we were, my blood pressure would elevate. Indeed. But when you work together and you follow a vision and you follow a leader who is honest with God, honest with the people, honest with his family, many significant things can happen and will happen. Oh, you're not hearing me. I just want to move away a little bit from what I have before me. There is nothing that you and I would not be able to accomplish when we're walking in the favor of God. Jehoiakim, the 18th king in Israel, decided that he would walk away from the plans and the purpose of God. As a result of his decision, God allowed the entire nation to go into captivity. And going into captivity, there were some young men who feared the Lord. And even though they were in a different country with a different culture and a different lifestyle, these men decided that they would walk with God. It seems to me, my brothers and sisters, it doesn't matter where you are. Doesn't matter what country you're in. If God is the same God who saved you where you came from, is the same God who can keep you even in this place and wherever you find yourself. Your conviction must not change by your location. Oh, let me say it again. Your conviction must not change by your location. Because God is sovereign. He cuts across borders. He has gone across every border, and your conviction must not change. Sometimes for some of us from the Caribbean, when we come through customs and immigration, we forget all of the principles that we were raised with. And suddenly we embrace a culture and some principles that are alien to the Word of God. I want to encourage us today and let you know that Lighthouse is founded on the Word of God. Not on me, but on the Word of God. On the Word of God. And every week, we seek to teach God's Word to God's people and to let them know that if the favor of God is upon you, there is no telling what God is capable of doing in your life. Let me give you a little story here on Thursday. Because we were sprinting. When we set the date for this dedication, we did not know all of the struggles and trouble with permits and all of the problems that you will have. And Maryland is different from New York. New York, you get a temporary permit, but Maryland does not issue a temporary occupancy permit. You have to get the full permit. It means that you've got to do everything before you can even get in the building. I wish it was New York, sir. We'd have been in the building a long time ago. But that's how they operate. And God blessed them. And God granted us favor with these inspectors. Yeah. Granted us favor. They were professional. They were tough. But yet God granted us favor with them on Thursday. The fire marshal came into this building. And before the company that installed the fire alarm system tested the fire alarm system, and all these little gadgets you see in the ceiling were working well. There's a fire detected in this building. Leave. Get out to all the exits and leave the building. They were all speaking to us in a nice female voice. On Thursday, when the fire marshal came into this building, the other parts of the building started to work, but the sanctuary refused to work. I said, the devil is a liar. This is the place where deliverance would take place. The offices and the fellowship hall on my right, and the storeroom and on my right. Things are working in there, but not in here. My wife came to me. I was bracing up to the sound booth at the back, and she said, Pastor, you need to pray. And I said, the devil is not going to mess with us. We are dedicating this building, come hell, come high water, on Sunday the 27th. This building will be dedicated to Jesus. And no demon is going to create any problem here. There's some demons you cancel and some you incarcerate. You saw the man who came up here, a police officer. But let me move forward. And I said, Lord Jesus, we've come too far. We've made too many sacrifices. For this thing not to work, it was working. And now, Father, I don't know what the situation is, but I don't care what the enemy is doing. I'm just asking you in the name of Jesus to let these things work. This marshal is not going to leave this building without giving us our certification. And the moment I said, in the name of Jesus, these fire alarm systems in this building started to talk to us, and the marshal stood here. He couldn't even understand what was going on. Let me tell you something. We serve a God who is alive, who is alive, who is alive. I want to be in a church where the Holy Ghost has the preeminence, and that miracles take place, and that God is at work. I don't want to be in a church that is the first church of the cold frigidaire. I'm too old for that. I'm too old for that. Too old for that.
Amen.
Too old for that kind of story. I want to see God work. I want to see God work. If God says he is able to work, I want to see God work. I've seen God perform miracles. People who had stage 4 cancer, God healed them. So if God can heal them of cancer, what is this little fire alarm system that's playing the fool? God has power to deal with it. When the favor of God is upon your life, God will work. We had an inspector who came in here and said, you got to measure the air, you got to measure this, you got to do this. And stuff that he was asking about, we would not have been able to get that done. And I said, God, you got to deal with this stuff. Just got to deal with it. You know, that inspector became favorably disposed to us. Favorably disposed to us and said, you guys are all right now. You guys are all right. You're ready to go. And on Friday, when the other building inspector who would give us a final permit to come in, came in, he said, where is the document? My wife had all the paperwork ready, and he just signed off on everything, and we were able to. When the favor of God is upon your life, you are going to be tested. As the first thing, I'll give you just 2 T's. You are going to be tested. When the favor of God is upon your life and you're walking in divine favor, you are going to be tested. The enemy will test you. Will test you, will test you. But if you walk with God, God will see you through. He is going to see you through. Daniel was tested, but yet God came through for him. You not only will be tested, but you are going to triumph. I told you I'm not going to be preaching long. I just want to get this thing over with. You are going to triumph. You are going to triumph. You are going to triumph. The test is going to come, but God is going to see you through. If God be for you, who can be against you? People will line up against you, but if God be for you, who can be against you? God will see you through. He's not going to allow you to go through the fire without causing you to triumph. He's not that kind of God. He will cause you to triumph in every situation. Daniel faced adversity, but yet God allowed Daniel to triumph.
Yes.
Joseph faced adversity, yet God allowed Joseph to triumph in the end. A man who was in prison, incarcerated for not doing the things that he was accused of. And God brought him from the prison to the palace, became the second man in charge in Egypt. Because when the favor of God is upon you, you'll be tested, but you are going to triumph over the situations around you. Can I hear the people of God today? Can I hear the people of God today? That you are going to triumph. No matter what they say, no matter what they do, you are going to triumph. I am near dumb. Let me tell you something else. I mean, I get on your face. You want to hear me in my real element come next Sunday at 10 o'clock. We're not going to have 10 o'clock for very long. We'll have an early service, and then we'll have a 10:30 service. And so God is doing some wonderful things in this church.
Amen.
A gentleman that I worked with, I was the first secretary of the International Board and Conference of the Wesleyan Church. First. Secretary of the International Board and Conference of the Wesleyan Church. I worked but this general superintendent had known me for years. I've got friends here who know me for 40 plus, beyond 40 years before I was a minister. And as a boy growing up in the church back in Guyana, the fear of God was something that was always on my mind, always before me, always before me. I never thought of backsliding, never entered into my mind as a boy, never entered into my mind. So you understand it's not going to happen now. I've seen too many moons and seen too many trouble and seen too many things happen, and I've seen God work in a tremendous way. So this whole matter of being trying to convince me that God is real, you're wasting time. I know that he's real, so I don't need to be convinced that he's real.
Amen.
I sat on that board. I worked with them as a consultant when they were not getting through with their plan to establish the International Board and Conference. They flew two of us in, one from Kenya, from Ghana, and they flew me in from Guyana to work as a consultant at the headquarters of the church to help them put this thing together. And they went through seven different plans before I could not agree on anything, and we started to work. And in a few hours, we put together the plan, went back the evening, and we started to fine-tune the plan. It became the International Board and Conference of the Wesleyan Church. And he knew that the hand of God was upon my life. And when things started to happen here in Maryland, and I thought that he would have been there to support, people are fickle. They'll change on you. They'll change on you. Put your trust in God, not in men. They'll change on you. They'll change on you. When I came here, I said, I don't want to be no superintendent or anything. I did that when I was a young man. I was 29 years old when I became a superintendent. And some of the hardest people to work with are pastors. Yes. Hardest people to work with are pastors. You're trying to get them to run with a vision, and they got all kinds of division going on. You're trying to get them to run with a vision, and they got all kinds of division going on. And the sum total of the story, to cut short, my relationship ended with the Wesleyan Church after 33 years of hard labor, sacrifice, and working in that church. Kicked to the curb, maligned, abused, all kinds of negative things circling around. In fact, the district in Guyana, I was the most successful district superintendent the Guyana district has ever known. When I became superintendent, it was 800 members. When I left, it was 5,000 members. The Bible school was a Bible institute. It became a college, fully accredited, offering from certificate to doctoral program. And the membership has gone back on the other side. And in spite of all of these things, kicked to the curb. You're going to be tested. Don't get bitter. Don't get bitter, or you will frustrate what God wants to do in your life. The dear gentleman wrote a letter saying, I am sorry that your ministry has been a failure in the United States of America. My brothers and sisters, I announce to you today, I love this failure. I really love this failure. I love this failure. Let me tell you something. When you allow men to write your destiny, you have to put up with what they say. I am not going to settle for what they say. I settle for what God says. Are you not hearing me this evening? I am not going to settle for what they say. I will settle for what God says. Are you hearing me? People would write you off. People would say that you're done. But if God hasn't said that, keep writing, keep fighting, keep moving, keep going on. Better days are ahead of you. Never allow people to write your destiny. Let God write your destiny. Ministry was never a failure. I've got people in this church who are custodians in that church, sweeping out used condoms from the basement of the church. When I started to come against that kind of nonsense, because the church was supposed to be a holiness church, and I was raised in the Pilgrim Holiness Church, and my mind and training, all of it has been a holiness training. And suddenly I ran into this, and it became repulsive to my spirit and repulsive to my conviction, and I could not stand it. I could not put up with it, and I started to preach and teach against it, and all hell broke loose against me. On the church board, leaders who were not living right, rather than honor God, came against the messenger. But the result of all of that, Lighthouse. Lighthouse. In 7 years, there are men that I know who are in schools for 23 years, men in school for 15 years, raising, building funds, and nobody seeing any progress. They ask me, how come you do it? I don't wear gaiters. The suit I got on cost me $90. You hear what I say? I don't wear gaiters. The suit I have will cost me $90. You gotta decide whether you want the work of God to go forward, or you wanna dress like a fool and waste the Lord's money and do stuff that you shouldn't do. I asked him, how can you get it done? I said, I'm gonna write a man and tell you how you get it done. Number one. The fear of God on your life. The fear of God on your life. The fear of God on your life. Respect for the people. Respect for the people. And if they have confidence in you, there is no telling what they will do. They'll stand behind you. The other thing is financial accountability. Yes. And like those, we don't have a treasurer. What? We don't have a treasurer. We have a finance committee. They handle the finance, they count the money, they deposit the money in the bank, and they upload it into the computer system, and it goes to a CPA company. Yes. Yes. And they handle the bookkeeping, because let me tell you something, if your books are not in order, no bank would deal with you, they wouldn't even talk to you. Yes. And not only that, we are IRS compliant, we have a certificate of good standing in the state of Maryland, and every year they renew it, they have to come and check the books, and they will discover that the books are in order. When we were dealing with the bank to get the money, the vice president of the loans department of Industrial Bank called me and said, when we met, you didn't give us a budget. I couldn't call brother so-and-so and say my son got soccer tomorrow, and you know, the next day they got football and they got some other thing. We needed it in 15 minutes. I picked the phone and called the accountant in that form and said, I need to get the budget right now. Pastor, I get it to you in 15 minutes. I said, from a conservative, you gotta understand, my wife is a little flamboyant, I'm conservative. I said, we're different, and the only reason we're together is because we're different. And I thank God for her. And so, I said, I don't want to increase the budget beyond 5%. And she said to me, come on, Pastor Cameron, you made 21% over the previous year. I can defend even going 20%. I said, make it 15. She said, no, 21%. I can defend it. In 15 minutes, she prepared it, sent it electronically. We printed it in the office, sent it electronically to the bank. The bank said, good to go. And people know that you are honest and you are somebody of integrity. They will stand with you and they will support you. So you ask, how do we get here? Integrity, fear of God, respect for the people. And if you put these things in order, you get your books in order, there's no telling of what you can accomplish. You're going to be tested, but you're going to triumph in the end. I want to say something more to you. Y'all look so wonderful today. Y'all look so wonderful today. Come on, give yourself a hand. Mrs. Cameron, please, don't go yet. You know, I want to celebrate my wife. I told her that I would celebrate her because she's been there sometimes. She to the members of the church, she's a tough girl, but to me, I normally say, she's tough to y'all, not to me. She's tough to y'all, not to me. And I would say, woman, I am not listening to you. You can't do this stuff. Just leave it alone. And she don't like the part, leave it alone. As a part, she don't really like, leave it alone. But she has been a tremendous source of blessing.
Amen.
She will work the front office, you will stand in the front, and I'm in the back with the men doing the construction here. I got a list of the names of the people, I can't call all of them. But you know, I want to, my daughter acknowledged them. So I would deal with the folk, the people deal with them in the front, then I will be here with the men. When the architect said to me, you need a project manager on this project, I said, how much money we gotta pay? And when I started here, what we gotta pay a project manager? And then I gotta find an office man, give him a telephone, pay for his gasoline. I said, I am appointing myself as the project manager of this project. We ain't got no money to pay nobody. I'm appointing myself as a project manager. He said, you need somebody who can read the plan. I can't read no plan. I can preach. I can't read no plan. But we have somebody in the congregation who can read the plan.
Yes.
And I said, I have to talk to you. I have Brother Alvarado who will talk to you. He can read the plan. So he spoke.
Yes.
And read the plan. We went up here. But I want to acknowledge the four people after I acknowledge my wife and the work that she did here. She worked hard.
Yes.
Just stop cooking for me. Because the girl over here all the time, but that's part of the thing. And I told her, I have lost a lot of weight so that I can be fit. And I extended my property. I made sure that my property is within the boundary line because I want to be here for a long time to help this congregation because I believe that we're not only going to be one congregation in Maryland or one congregation in the United States, we're going to be across borders as the Senate of the chaplain of the United States Senate, Dr. Barry Black, keep prophesying that I see this thing that he said, the International in this church's name is going to take you beyond the borders of this church. I have the experience. I've served as a district superintendent and as a regional superintendent over two countries. So that is nothing new or strange. But this young lady has worked hard.
Yes.
And thank God for her. I bought her this dress. Because I wanted to look real nice. You're doing a good job. That's a good picture. I charge you for it. And so, sometimes she's misunderstood by people, but she has a big heart. A big heart. Want to see the work of God go forward. And I thank God for her. We don't fight over anything. If I disagree, she knows I disagree with it. That's the end of it. That we need to move in one direction. And so we're not divided. We're together on what God wants us to do and to help his people to go forward. But just help me celebrate her. Just help me celebrate her. Thank you for what you've done. Come on, join Mr. Lockett. Thank you. Thank you. I want to thank Orin. Where is Orin? Where is Orin? He's not a rascal. Orin was born in England, lived in Tobago, and he's on our staff as a head musician here and directing the music flow. And Orin was our lead contractor. And he's a member of the church. We haven't paid him a penny. I said to them, we ain't got no money to pay nobody. The work got to be done. I am very tough. And Orin came here for about several months, working every day, leaving late in the night, without pay, without anything, and got the job done. I believe Brother James is in the congregation. Samuel James, he's not here. Samuel James, he followed Orin, the two of them, working. Come, Brother Alvarado, Ronaldo Alvarado, pray for this brother, he gives me trouble. Just pray for him. Born in El Salvador. Remember, Brother Alvarado is skilled in so many areas. He goes to work for 4 o'clock in the morning, works with the Park and Planning Commission here in PG. And he comes off at 3 o'clock from work, he comes here and work until 7 o'clock in the night, or sometimes as I would squeeze him more out of him. Once I get him an Inca Cola, which is a thing that is a sweeter than honey, and I don't know how you do this kind of stuff. So I said, you're poisoning yourself. But I found out that if I give him an Inca Cola, I get more work out of him. So I have to buy more Inca Cola and keep them so when he's slowing down, he's not able to function. I give him a can of Inca Cola to keep him going. Anyway. He has been here doing all kinds of work. Whatever I asked him to do, he would do and work and come here and do all kinds of work. Then, where is Roberto? Y'all can't make Roberto? Oh, he had to leave. Roberto is the electrician. The man has a prosthesis leg, but that did not worry him. He pulled all of this stuff together and passed the electrical inspection. Passed the first, passed the second, passed the final. And there was Robert Swaby. Where is Robert? Please, Robert, come on. You're calling the lead ones. There are a number of other folk who back up with them. He is the HVAC man. He's a member of the church. Where is Rowan? Where is Rowan? Come, Rowan. The two of these two members of the church. I said to them, you two guys, the HVAC men, I'm paying nobody any money to get anything done. And Robert has been the lead man to take care of all the air conditioning of this building, make sure, check them, that working and everything in order, along with Rowan, to be the members of the church. I think I baptized both of them. Brother Brown, where is Brother Brown? Y'all get me, Brother Brown, where is he? This is Brother L.J. Brown, man from Jamaica. Land from Water. This is his son. Father and son got baptized at the same time. Brother Brown is a master painter. You see this in here? This is Brother Brown. And you had Brother Keith with him, his son-in-law. Where is Brother Keith? Oh, Brother Keith is in the choir. He worked with him. We had Brother Sparks work with him. We had some of the ladies who work with him. And all these ladies who work with Brother Brown, please give me a wave. You had Sister Maynard, Sister Norma, Sister Juanita, Sister Cameron, Sister, come give me some other names. I got my people down here. Brother Sparks and all these other ladies who worked. But of course Sister Norma. But with the electrician, I had somebody who knew nothing about that kind of work. He learned the work right here on this project. We're provoking him to go to school and to be certified. Where is Chris? Where is Chris? You know anything, you ask him to pull up a plug, he'll kill you with it. But now he can pull up everything around the place. He is an in-house electrician. We just bless God. Quarterly. And I want the cooks, let me tell you, we got some phenomenal cooks there. They're licensed, insured, and bonded. Caterers in this church. Where is Sister Jean? Where is Sister Philpotts? Down in the choir. Where is Sister Jean? You're preparing food, come quickly. Where is Sister Valerie Philpotts? Where is Sister Yvonne Jones? Where is Sister Winsome Jones? Where is Sister Brown? Get me some good Escovitch fish. Oh, no, how'd you come? Born in Jamaica, but came to Ethiopia. I don't know what's going on with that. And every week, folk would make sure the food is here. And where is Sister Winsome Sparks? Because her name is on my list. Where is Sister Winsome Sparks? Please come, Sister Winsome. Sister Winsome, cook me some awesome food. Oh, you get fat. I told her, please, I'm not going back there. I'm not going back there. Not going back there. The bank said, we've got to test your blood pressure. We've got to test your sugar. I ain't got no problem with sugar. My sugar count, glucose count is always perfect. I never had any problem with it. Always perfect. I can eat or drink the Inca Cola and it's still perfect. But I stay away from the Inca Cola. Getting crazy like my brother. She had a husband and the other folk who chipped in behind the scene. If your name is not called, please understand that I ain't called by name too. Good? So don't be bothered. The pastor name is not called. And so I want to thank all of these people. Help me celebrate them. Help me celebrate them. Amen. Lots of other members of the church who work hard, men behind the scene. Brother Isaac, who is on the board, he was clean up. Oh, I miss Pastor Goddard. Where is Pastor Goddard? I saw him slip through the door, isn't he? He's in one of the overflow room. Oh, he had to slip up. But this is his wife. He did all the plumbing work for us free of cost. Pastor John, please stand to salute so people acknowledge him. Your husband. And we've got a young woman here, she's from St. Kitts Nevis, named Norma. She can do all kinds of stuff. Where is Norma?
Yes.
She had to leave her. Oh, Jimmy, why y'all tell me Norma? You look, Norma, come here. Norma was up with the men on the wall, cutting drywall, because the drywall had to go right up to the ceiling. Not only doing that, normally tiles over there, but we had to put up some tiles. And Norma was here with Orin and Rowan putting up these flat screens yesterday. This is Norma. Can do anything around the place. So when I asked the members of the church to volunteer, I couldn't say men. I said men and women because I knew we had some able-bodied women. And please help me to acknowledge Mr. Lockett. With all his wisdom. And come, Mr. Lockett. Mr. Lockett. Come, Mr. Lockett, you can come on the platform, no problem. He's from NAI Michael Company, as vice president. I dealt with the rogue before. We only lose, Mr. Lockett, that day was a tremendous day. We lost $4,800 to that guy that you spoke to me about when you asked him, can you show me any building that you were able to finance? And he couldn't show you anything. And you said to him, I can show you what I built as an architect, as an engineer, the Camelot and so many other places, and the guy could not show anything. And let me warn pastors, anytime you're dealing with people who offer you private finance, and you can never meet them in their office, always meeting them at Panera Bread, at McDonald's, that kind of story, red flags, be careful, be wary, you're dealing with a rogue. And Mr. Lockett took me aside, put his arm on my shoulder, and he said, Pastor Cameron, I will work with you, give you all the advice, the professional advice you need, free of cost, get you into a building. Do not worry with that guy. I am worried about him. And I took that advice very seriously and decided I work with Mr. Lockett. And Mr. Lockett got us this building. And he found it. He said, I want to come. I want to see it again. And to be with Mr. Lockett. Please, if somebody else, y'all come up. And we had Sister Pammy from New Gen who worked with us cutting things, cutting mill. Where is Sister Pammy? And partners in crime. We go back a long. Come, Sister Pammy. We attended Christian Labor College together. We gave the principal at Christian Labor College trouble, Tian and Sanko, the two of us. I was a student president and she was a secretary. And we give the man all kind of trouble. All kind of trouble. This problem, no, believe it or not. She broke me out. But I want to thank God for all the other brethren who work. Can't call all the other names because it can take too long. And God bless you and God prosper you. Amen?
Amen.
So once again, please let these folk feel. Thank you. Let me do this dedication and then the choir as they're getting set to come. Let me just do the dedication. I trust that we have the litany on screen. Can we get the litany on the screen? I can read everything far. I don't know what's the problem. I get too close. I want to tell you got 2020 vision, but I'll come when I get this fine stuff up here. I gotta get a funny spectacle. Somebody asked me, a pastor, is your spectacle broke? I said, no. I don't need you to do anything else. Please, let's get the litany. And I wanna ask you to stand with me as they put the litany up. If they don't have it ready for you, I'll read it. I'll tell you what you, the only thing you need to say is we dedicate this church. That's all you need to say. We dedicate this church. That's all you need to say. And I'll read for you. And to the glory of God the Father, who has called us by his grace and mercy, to the honor of Jesus Christ, who loved us and gave himself for us. Praises to the blessed Holy Spirit, who illuminates and sanctifies us by his power, congregation.
We dedicate this church.
For the worship of God in prayer and praise.
We dedicate this church.
for preaching and teaching the inspired word of God and the manifestation of the gifts of the Spirit.
We dedicate this church.
For the celebration of the holy sacraments.
We dedicate this church.
When your people are in distress and they come to these altars and pray, hear and answer their cries, O Lord.
We dedicate this church.
For the comfort of all who mourn.
We dedicate this church.
For spiritual strength for those who are tempted to do wrong.
We dedicate this church.
For light to those who are in darkness.
We dedicate this church.
For the building of strong Christian families.
We dedicate this church.
For teaching and guiding the young in pursuit of God's divine purpose.
We dedicate this church.
For the perfecting of the saints in the most holy faith.
We dedicate this church.
For the conversion of sinners.
We dedicate this church.
For the sanctification of believers.
We dedicate this church.
For the promotion of righteousness. For the extension of the kingdom of God.
We dedicate this church.
In the unity of the faith. In the bond of Christian brotherhood. In charity and goodwill to all.
We dedicate this church.
In gratitude for the labor of all who love and serve this church. In loving remembrance of those who have finished their course in the hope of a blessed immortality through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Lord.
We dedicate this church.
And everyone now,
the people of this church,
surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, grateful for our heritage, sensible of the sacrifice of our fathers in the faith,
confessing that apart from us,
their work cannot be made perfect, do dedicate ourselves
anew
to the worship
and service of the
Father, the Son,
and the Holy Ghost.
And the church says,
amen.
Bishop Colin Esseboom, whom I've known for a number of years, out of Guyana, World Vision New Testament Church of God. He's now pastoring and residing in Canada. He's going to come and pray the prayer of dedication. I want to invite all of my ministerial colleagues who are here to come and stand along with my wife. I want to ask members of the board to come quickly. All of my ministerial colleagues who are here to come quickly. Stand on the platform. Come, Reverend Gregorio. I might have taken away stuff from you, but you're still a minister. Amen. This is Pastor Dundas, only for a number of years from the Nazarene Church in Queenstown, in Georgetown. God bless you. Amen. And my friend, who don't want to put on the camera, Reverend Colin Edgehill, who has been my host many times in the television program back in Guyana, flew in especially for this dedication. Go ahead, work your camera. Yeah.
So to God in prayer. Father in heaven, God of hosts, enthroned above the cherubim, you are God alone. Of all the kingdoms of the earth, you have made heaven and earth according to your word. There is no God like unto you, in heaven above or on earth beneath, keeping covenant and showing steadfast love to your servants who walk before you with all their heart. Lord, we come to you this day to sanctify and set apart this sanctuary, this house of God,
amen,
as a place of refuge.
Amen.
And we say that it is most holy unto the Lord according to your word in Leviticus, the 2nd chapter, the 28th verse. Let your eyes be open towards this house,
yes,
night and day, and make your name great here,
yes,
in the name of Jesus. Great Jehovah, make your name great here in the name of Jesus Christ. And whenever your people who are called by your name, when they make prayers and supplication from this house, with humility, seeking you honestly, earnestly, having turned from their wicked ways, hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and maintain their right and defend their cause in the name of Jesus. When they come together in unity, O God, let your Holy Spirit display and manifest your presence. Let there be an eruption of supernatural power in their lives in the name of Jesus, causing salvation, healing, deliverance, freedom, miracles, signs, and wonders that will glorify your name, that will cause souls to be saved, and that will edify the kingdom of God here on earth.
Yes.
Our Father God, let it be as we seek you first, as we fear you, as we search for you wholeheartedly, that you will cause favor to break out among us. And that favor will not only break out, it will stay with us and it will grow. Let us grow in favor both with God and with men in the name of Jesus. Even so, God, let your people build this sanctuary, a place of divine exchange, a place of contact with heaven, an altar where you meet with us, so that anyone who enters this sanctuary, including the stranger, the unsaved, they will be transformed and have their lives changed and have a life-altering encounter in the name of Jesus. And now, O God, favor us by opening the heavens over your people and blessing the work of your hands as we have dedicated this place to the glory of God, to the saving of souls, to the edifying of the church. In the name of Jesus, let the church say amen.
Amen.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Let the church say amen, amen. Again. And give the Lord a wonderful round of applause.
Thank you, ministers. Just before the choir comes to, don't worry, we have lots of food. Food and drinks and juice. You can have your seats. I will ask Pastor Chester, because of time, the mistake he will make is to put a mic in the hands of a pastor to bring a greeting. You won't come out of here till tomorow morning. So,
everybody got a minute.
Pastor Chester is going to speak on behalf of the pastor. That's what we're going to do today. We're going to speak on behalf of the pastors so that we'll have people to interact with each other. You'll get, if you want to visit the facility and see what it is. So we need to give you some time to do that. So Pastor Chester, you will speak on behalf of your church, but then you will speak on behalf of all the pastors. Thank you.
The Lord is good. This is the Lord's doing. I'm telling you this, but this is the Lord's doing. This is not Pastor Cameron's doing. This is not the board's doing. Look at him and say, but this is the Lord's doing. And it's marvelous. Give the Lord a round of applause, everybody. Good to see all of you today. And I'm going to ask the walking team with me, praise God. I'm going to ask them to come to stand just behind me, praise God, members from our church. But I'm not just bringing greetings from our church. I'm speaking on behalf of the all the pastors here. These are some of the folks that came with me, praise God, all the way from Brooklyn. We're located in Brooklyn and in Queens, one church in two locations. We're in Utica Avenue and we're in St. Albans, that's Queens, near to the airport. The Lord is good. I am here not to talk about what God is doing. Last week we had our first service in our building, but I'm here to celebrate my friend. See you, somebody. And it's way, way back, praise God. Have with me, praise God, some good friends here. Amen. This is one of our executive administrators. Praise God. Pastor Dion, this is her husband. Give him a round of applause, everybody. Dion Lewis, and brother and sister Hunter. Praise God. Give him a round of applause, everybody. Praise God. They are special individuals, praise God, members of our church. Praise God. Pastor Cameron. First Lady, members of the Board of Trustees and members of Lighthouse Assemblies International, tell your neighbor this is an international church.
This is
no ordinary church.
This is
an international church. I bring you greetings for my wife and family. I also bring you greetings for the leaders of our church and also from the other pastors that are here. Today, it's forever marked in history. I'm here along with a team to celebrate God's goodness to you, your family, and your ministry. Where you're seated today is a fruit of great faith. Say great faith, somebody.
Great faith.
But we've been in this thing, I'm telling you, it caused a lot of faith. And much prayer. And I know you'll be praying. Great faith that moved the hands of God. I'm talking about persistent kind of faith that refused to give up in the face of delays. And there were much delays in this church, praise God. Roadblocks. How many of you know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
The members of this church know what I'm talking about. Turns and twists. Surprises. Criticism. Doubt. And even naysayers. Pastor Cameron. Dr. Cameron. Amen. Angel of this house, my good friend, choose to stand on the word of God and the promises of God, which is true. God's word says, I will build my church. Tell you, this is God's church. Come on. Said, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail. Surely what we see here today is God's doing. It's truly, as I said, it's truly marvelous. The Bible says that he who started a good work is able to complete it. Here we see evidence of God's completion. We see evidence of God's being in every God-sized vision. And this man is a visionary. I pray that the hand of God and his presence and his protection be upon his, continue to be upon his life and his family. My brother, you prayed and God answered.
Yes.
Church, you prayed?
Yes.
And God came through for you.
Amen.
Like he did for Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and Joseph and David and all the patriarchs. Believers, as I celebrate, I can't help but reflect on the fact that my friendship and my brother started over a generation ago. How many years in a generation? Over 40 years ago, I know this brother. So don't calculate our age. We are still young. I saw this brother when I was in my teens. And after knowing him for such a long time, I discovered, you know, we met each other. He was brought to the church by a man of God, Pastor Vantall brought him. And they were doing evangelism. I was just a young Christian, and they came to minister in our church. After several years, I discovered that his mom and my parents came not only from the same country, but the same village. This world is a small world in Guyana. And we became much closer to each other and connected. Because both of us were more than just, you know, not just spiritual. Amen. But we were involved in cricket. How many of you know about cricket? I tried to teach my children, the boys, to play cricket. And it's a difficulty. Amen. They just accustomed to baseball. So I gave up. Because they were born right there. But we knew each other for a very long time in cricket. And I want to tell you something. We competed among each other several times. And your pastor is very, very, very competitive. He was a good all-rounder. He was a good cricketer. He had a lot of passion and determination. However, we defeated his team several times. Because we made him not the team, we made him a study. Because one person can't win a cricket game. And he was good. So we had everything cut out for him. He was a good man, praise God. But once again, we defeated several times. But thank God, with Jesus, we are all winners. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
Because of Pastor Cameron's passion and anointing the Holy Spirit, his vision, commitment to his calling, and dedication, faithfulness to God, he later became a senior pastor, which you talk about. He then subsequently became superintendent of an organization. And we continue to be connected. We pray, we encourage each other. Amen. And God has blessed him throughout all the difficulties. Say difficulties, somebody.
Difficulties.
Throughout all the trials in this country. Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
And because of the trials, Sister Cameron, and Pastor, my brother, Pastor Cameron, because of the trials, God allowed the trials. If it wasn't for the trials, as like Andrea Kell said, through it all, I've learned to trust in Jesus. Through it all, I've learned to trust in God. Ever been a problem?
What could be the God that solved the problem?
And because of the trials, in his previous organization, we have this church.
Amen.
So how do you know that God did not allow the trials to take our brother higher?
Yes.
Could somebody say praise the Lord, somebody? The Bible said, all things work together for good. They meant it for evil, but God had another plan. Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
He said, all things work together for good for those that love the Lord and are called to his promises. Pastor Cameron, keep trusting God. Lady Cora and Diane Cameron, the wife of his youth, and truly she's a helpmeet. She really, really complements his ministry. I should say she embodies a very goal-oriented and an energized person. She has the ability to influence those around her to benefit the ministry and the glory of God. And hear this one. Even though many may get mad, whilst others get mad, some others get glad. She's a great woman, full of energy. And I say once again, they complement each other. Along with them, they have their wonderful children. Amen. And the ministry has grown today where it is because of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The team, the family, and the children came together. And I want to encourage all of you to remember them in prayer. I will conclude by saying today, thank God for the members of the board. Continue to work for Jesus. Continue to work as a team. Today is a new chapter in this church.
Amen.
Say amen, somebody.
Amen.
Amen. Today is a new chapter. The work has just what?
Begun.
The work has just
begun.
Brother Pastor Cameron, Sister Cameron, the work has just what?
Begun.
Because this is a mega church.
Yes.
Say amen. This is a great church.
Yes.
Amen. And the church is going to another level. And this church is called up to reach this community. Praise the name of the Lord. And I thank God. I didn't know that somebody prophesied. But the Lord told me that this church is called to reach nations,
yes.
Communities, amen, and cities around the world.
Amen.
Keep praying for this church. Amen. And I decree that the best is yet to come. God bless you. God bless you, everybody.
A few years ago, Sister Juanita and myself decided that Lighthouse Ministry is an organization of power and we need to have our own anthem. We sat down together, we put the words together, so I want you to listen to the words of the song, which tells the story of Lighthouse Ministries International. And as I said to the choir, this is only the beginning. We're going to be going places. We're going to be as popular as the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir. Amen?
Amen.
Brooklyn Tabernacle will be singing our songs. Amen. That's the thrill of my heart. So it's a praise God for Lighthouse. We are now 7 years strong for the visionary, our pastor Cameron. We will do more. A condition we'd still be in today if God's plan of Lighthouse had never come our way. Praise God. Amen. Yes, I'm here.